I want to jump right in today by reading some scripture. It's found in 2 Peter chapter 1. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that to pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. God wants us to have everything that pertains to life and to godliness, and he has the knowledge of what is necessary for us to have in order to have everything for life and for godliness. And he has the wisdom to know how to grant that to us in such a way that we will be able to really and truly appreciate what God has granted to us. So we need to just praise God. We need to just turn our lives over completely to God. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I just pray that every one of us involved in this program today will, in our way, with the help of the Holy Spirit, commit ourselves anew to the power and to the presence of Almighty God. We want to have all of our needs met, but more important even than that is for us to be just as close to God as we possibly can. So, Father God, we're asking that you draw us closer and closer to the precious bleeding side of Jesus so that we can worship you and honor you always in spirit and in truth. We want to lift your holy name up and thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to Revelation of the Word with hosts Dr. and Mrs. M.E. Neal.
Today I'm going to do a little bit differently from what I normally do. I like to use a lot of scripture in my messages. If you were tuned in last program, I briefly talked about the goodness of God. And I made the statement, God is good. And then all of the time, God is good. So here's what I want to do differently today. I want to continue that thought of how awesome and how great and how good our God is. But rather than giving you scripture today, oh dear, what is he going to do? You know, you may be wondering. I'm not a real good singer, so I'm not going to sing for you, but I am going to read the words of a song to you. And it's a song that you most likely have heard by Chris Tomlin. And it says, "Oh, I've heard 1,000 stories of what they think you're like. But I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night. And you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers only you provide. 'Cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Because you are perfect in all your ways. You are perfect in all your ways. You are perfect in all your ways to us. You're perfect in all your ways. Oh, you're perfect in all your ways. You're perfect in all your ways to us. Oh, it's love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think. As you call me deeper still. As you call me deeper still. As you call me deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. You are perfect in all your ways. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. You are perfect in all your ways. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. That song says so much about the goodness of God. It talks about the fact that God uses His wisdom to bless us. It's His desire to give us everything that pertains to life and to godliness. Philippians 4:19 says, "And my God shall supply all your need according to His riches in glory." 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 and 3 says, "Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as His divine power hath given us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him that has called us to glory and virtue." You see, we believers are only creatures who desire to use the God-given given blessings in the service of God in order to bless Him. Now, I want to repeat that so that you understand. God has made everything. That includes every creature that there is. Now, some of the creatures, I question, God, why did you make snakes? Why did you make spiders? Well, God had a reason for doing it. God knows what's best, for sure. But we as believers are the only creatures that God has made, that God has given His blessings to, so that we can, in return, bless Him with those blessings. Do you understand what I'm saying? So, we get to enjoy God's blessing in a richer and fuller measure more than any other creature, because we get to take those blessings and we get to turn them back in a vertical direction and say, God, I bless you as you have blessed me. So please understand that even though we are the only creatures that can turn around and bless God by using those same blessings, in a sense, God allows the little birds or other animals to add beauty and glory to this world. And in a sense, that's a blessing to Him. But even so, even though He knows every little sparrow, still they are not able to bless Him in the way that we as believers are able to bless Him. So what I'm hoping that you're getting out of this message is take the blessings that God has given to you, whatever they may be, and use them to bless Him in return. Now that doesn't mean that God stops blessing and caring for the animals and the other things that He has created and placed here on earth. He cares for those things for sure, but not in the same way that He cares for human beings. God sent His only begotten Son that whosoever, whatever, whoever human being believes in Him, should not perish, but have everlasting life. God loves the human beings, and it's His desire, has always been, for all to be saved. That doesn't happen. Not everybody accepts Jesus. Not everybody receives the plan of salvation. But it's God's will. He loved us all so much that He sent the second person of the Godhead to die in our stead. But again, He cares even for the creatures that are in the wild, so to speak. Psalm 36, verses 5 and 6 says, "Thy mercy, O Lord, is in the heavens, and Thy faithfulness reacheth unto the clouds. Thy righteousness is like the great mountains. Thy judgments are a great deep. O Lord, Thou preservest man and beast." So God's hand is upon everything. I mentioned the little sparrow. He knows every little sparrow, and He knows when one of them falls dead. He understands that. And He has made that little sparrow. But again, He loves you even more. He loves all mankind, and He loves all creatures. But man is the only creature that can receive the blessings of God, reverse them, and bless God with them. Psalm 104, verses 10, starting there, going all the way through verse 22, says, "He sendeth the springs into the valley, which runs among the hills. They give drink to every beast of the field. The wild asses quench their thirst. By them shall the fowls of heaven have their habitation and sing among the branches." So God cares for the animals. "He watereth the hills from His chambers. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of Thy works. He causeth the grass to grow for the cattle, an herb for the service of man." Again, my point is, we as humans are the only ones that can really accept the plan of salvation. But God still cares for everything else. God is a caring God. God is a good, good God. Hallelujah. So He causes the grass to grow for the cattle and the herb for the service of man, that He may bring forth fruit, food out of the earth, and wine that maketh glad the heart of man, and oil to make his face to shine, and bread which strengtheneth man's heart. The trees of the Lord are full of sap, the cedars of Lebanon which He hath planted, where the birds make their nests. As for the storks, the fir trees are her house. The high hills are a refuge for the wild goats, and the rocks for the conies. He appointed the moon for seasons. The sun knoweth his goings down. Thou makest darkness, and it is night, wherein all the beasts of the forest do creep forth. The young lions roar after their prey and seek their meat from God. The sun ariseth. They gather themselves together and lay them down in their dens. God's got it all worked out. Everything is for the glory of Jesus Christ. But again, man is the greatest creation that God brought into existence, because He made us in His image, in His likeness, and He has granted to us His divine nature. He has given us His kind of life. And yes, He even gives us His kind of ways, even though His ways are higher than our normal human ways, and His thoughts are higher than our normal human thoughts. Yet He has made it possible for us to acquire His wisdom. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, and God will give it to him liberally, and He won't withhold it. Hallelujah. So God takes care of us, but he also takes care of everything else. You see, even before the foundation of the world, it was determined that all of creation was to be a glorious inheritance for Jesus Christ, the second person of the Godhead. Now, that has not actually come about as of yet in the sense of being totally fulfilled. It will after the rapture has occurred and we're caught up into heaven and the tribulation period happens here on earth. And then at the end of the tribulation period, the glorious appearance of Jesus takes place. He comes all the way to the earth. And then we find that 1,000 years reign is brought about as Jesus rules and reigns here on earth. And we, the saints of God, get to rule and reign with him. And then after that, there's the judgment. All of evil is cast into the lake of fire. And all of the righteous are made and given eternal life. The new heaven and the new earth are brought about. Heaven descends to the earth and sets up its placement here on earth. We are able to go in and out of the heavenly city, the New Jerusalem. All of that is a fulfillment of the plan of salvation that originated even before the foundation of the world. And it included Jesus having to die on the cross for man's sin. But God the Father said, Son, by your doing this, all that we create, all of the people that we bring into existence, and God is the one who makes us. God is the one who places the animals here on earth. All of the beauty of the creation is to be given to you as a glorious inheritance. And that will be fulfilled after all of these other events have taken place. Matthew chapter 5, verse 45 says that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. You see, God loves everybody. Even sinners, God loves sinners. He doesn't love what they do, but he still loves them. And he would like for all sinners to become his children. And he has provided the means by which that is possible. The precious blood of Jesus washing away their sin. Matthew chapter 6, beginning with verse 25 says, Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? And the answer is yes. Verse 26 says, Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, neither gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wow, that's so exciting. Think about the prettiest flower that you can imagine. And no matter how much money, how much wisdom we as humans have, there is no way that we can come up with our own ability to come close to comparing to the beauty that God has made. And yet God still loves us more than all of the rest of creation. For it was only for us as humans that he sent Jesus into this world. Verse 29, and yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these flowers. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you? And the answer is yes. He loves you even more than he loves the lilies of the field, or the birds of the air, or the cedars of Lebanon. He loves you so much more than that. And if he clothes them and feeds them, how much more he will do for us. But if we question it, the answer comes back, O ye of little faith. God forbid that any of us will ever hear those words spoken to us, that we are without faith, or that our faith is little. If you examine yourself right now and you say, but it's hard to believe all of these things that are in the Bible, then you say, God, I am questioning some of your word. I am exhibiting little faith, but your word tells me that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so for that reason, even though my faith is weak right now, I dedicate myself to studying your word more so that my faith can grow and I can get to know you better. He says, therefore take no thought saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewith shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. Oh me, we are Gentiles, but I'm sure the Jewish people also seek those things. But anyway, for your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. Now, listen to this verse. Don't know whether you underline verses in the Bible or not, but if you do, here's a good one. Verse 33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you. We are human beings. God has made us as to be the one who has dominion over this earth. He gave dominion to Adam and Eve. Adam gave it away. But Jesus came to restore that dominion to us, for us. And so if we will seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then we will be granted dominion over everything else. All these things shall be added unto you. 3 John verse 2, I love this verse. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. Folks, we are serving, first of all, a living God, a God who made everything that there is and is above everything that there is. There's only one God who exists, namely in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One God, though, who is above everything else. And this one God has all intelligence, nothing lacking. He knows everything that has ever been, that is going on right now, or that will ever be. He knows it. He knew it even before creation took place. But he built his word. Everything that he has declared before the foundation of the world and is currently declaring through his written word and through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, everything that he has declared it based on absolute truth. And he has declared that he will always be faithful to the nth degree in everything that he has spoken, so that you and I can have everything that pertains to life and to godliness. Can you say, praise the Lord? Hallelujah.
Do you have prayer requests? Please call or write to us. You can support Revelation of the Word by first praying for God's anointing to be on this ministry. If you feel led to send a financial offering, you can send your gift to Revelation of the Word Ministries, 205 Liberty Lane, Madison, Tennessee, 37115. Everyone is invited to visit Revelation of the Word Church. Call, email, or write to Niels for more information. Now, back to Revelation of the Word.
I don't know about you, but I sense the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit right here, right now. And within my spirit, the only thing that I want to say is hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise your holy name. You're an awesome God. You're a mighty God. You're a holy God. And you love us. You love us even though we are imperfect in many, many ways. You still love us. And you call us your children. You have declared that as believers, we are saints, that we are children of the Most High God, that we are heirs to a great inheritance along with Jesus. You love us and you care for us, and we worship you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for calling us to be ambassadors for the cause of Almighty God. Thank you for helping us to reach out to other people and to let them know that God loves them and that God wants to bless them and that God wants them to prosper and be in health in every way. God is good, and we want to worship Him. Hallelujah. Now, quickly, I want to say again, thank you for viewing Revelation of the Word. It's people like you that has made it possible for this program to be on television. And I say to you, if you have an offering that you don't know what to do with it, give it to WHTN. I assure you that everybody here is a Christian and will use the money according to the will of God. Hallelujah. Remember, God loves you, and we do too. Amen.
You can join the Niels here on WHTN every Saturday at noon, or you can visit Revelation of the Word Church. Contact the Niels for more information.